My name is Barry Colfer. I'm the Director of Research here at the Institute. A very warm welcome to those joining here in person and those joining online. Just a very important health warning from our friend and colleague, Nora Owen, was just mentioning that this is one of the worst streets in the city for clamping, Nora. Is that what you were saying? So anyone who's parked outside and hasn't paid the toll, just be prepared to pay a price. Really great to have everybody here welcoming you to the fourth John Hume European Spirit of Peace Award. It's not the first one that we've been able to collaborate with the John and Pat Hume Foundation over. Indeed, our very first event when I was a young director of research back in 2022, the first event after the pandemic, we were able to celebrate and have this a previous version of this lecture. So really, really happy to be working again with the John and Pat Hume Foundation, Tim Atwood and colleagues. So welcome back and look forward to the next interaction already. I'm going to have a very easy job this evening because I can just enjoy the discussion. But I do just want to say on behalf of the Institute, a very warm welcome to Simon Coveney, who literally requires no introduction, I think, to this audience. Simon has had a distinguished career and record in politics, Minister for Agriculture, Minister for Foreign Affairs, Tánaiste, and indeed TD for the people at Cork South Central from 1998 until very recently. One of those constituencies that elects ministers and not just TDs. So based on how well you look, Simon, you must have gone into the office after your junior cert or something, if you're there since 1998. So it's a real pleasure to have you here at this kind of auspicious week, obviously after the elections of last week. But I just want to acknowledge Etain Tanham as well, another friend of the Institute. Thanks very much, Etain, for holding the ring tonight. And so Etain is going to be your MC. And it is just my duty now to hand over to Mark Durkin, who's going to say a couple of words. Where are you, Mark? Come on up, Mark is going to say a couple of words on behalf of the John and Pat Hume Foundation. Thanks very much. Over to you, Mark.
Okay. Thank you very much, Barry. Can I thank Barry and colleagues at the IIEA, and including Alex White, for hosting us here this evening for the John Hume Spirit of Peace lecture. On behalf of the Hume Foundation, I want to also acknowledge the work of Tim Atwood and again helping to put this event and so many others together, and we had another event in Belfast last night as well. So the foundation is working on a number of different fronts and a number of different levels. We've gathered here this evening to listen to Simon Coveney, who, as Barry says, needs no introduction, so I'm not going to rehearse a whole introduction and go through a pen portrait of Simon Coveney. We all know why he is such an eloquent person to and eligible person to give this particular lecture, given his ministerial experience, but also his personal attributes. So in terms of the work he has done at the wider European level, in terms of a rights-based approach to advancing a wider democratic European space amidst all of the challenges, all of the complexity perplexity that we have in the world at the minute, but also at a more national level, the consideration and the attention to detail that he's shown in respect of our own process of political advance, reconciliation and further embedding the Good Friday Agreement, the contribution that he made to helping to change a picture of impasse into one where there was impetus with restoration of the institutions is something that shouldn't be taken for granted by any of us. So he has real experiences and real perspectives that we can benefit from this evening. So we're here to look forward to that. You didn't come to hear me introducing him. There are words and material available about the Hume Foundation as well, so I'll not take up your time with too much of an advertisement for the broader and wider work of the Foundation. So I will allow things to proceed this evening, and I'll ask Etain, who will then chair events. So after Simon has spoken, there will be some discussion, and we'll be in the Etain Tanham's hands for that. So thank you all very much indeed.
Unfortunately, the first thing I have to say is I can't move from this chair because of the microphone, because I've no pockets. So I'm sorry. I feel it's very undignified and disrespectful to Mr. Coveney. I do want to say briefly about, firstly, to welcome Simon Coveney, Mr. Coveney, and to thank the IIEA and the John and Pat Hume Foundation as well. It is an honour to be here, and I think very good timing to reflect at this time as well on the past Brexit years. I am going to have a little biography of Simon Coveney's experience and also of the John and Pat Hume Foundation, just to, I suppose, remind everyone of the origin of this lecture at the Spirit of Peace, which is in partnership with the John and Pat Hume Foundation and recognises those who have demonstrated a strong commitment to European Union principles. In this day and age, I wonder, should I say positive principles? Because I know, you know, in different European countries, there's so many different strains now, but that Simon Coveney really has shown such a commitment to those values that many of us were brought up with and value that perhaps we can't take for granted anymore. So it's an honor really to welcome you here and to hear your thoughts. Mr. Coveney will speak for 20 minutes or so, and then I will ask a few questions, but really open it up to you and to our online audience. And I encourage our online audience also to remember to ask questions as they arise and as you think of them in your heads. A quick reminder that today's presentation and the Q&A are both on the record. And as everyone has said, I think Simon Coveney doesn't need an introduction, but nevertheless, given his achievements, I am going to briefly present one. Simon Coveney served as Minister for Enterprise, Trade and Employment from 2022 to 2024. He also served as Deputy Leader of Fine Gael from 2017 to 2024. He previously served as Minister for Foreign Affairs and Minister for Defence and was Ireland's Brexit spokesperson, which I think none of us need to say, through the Brexit negotiations. Mr. Coveney was Tánaiste there from November 2017 to June 2020. And has also held roles as Minister for Housing, Planning and Local Government and Minister for Agriculture, Food and the Marine. Mr. Coveney represented Cork South Central constituency from 1998 until November 2024. And I suppose I should add a little slight anecdote that, not anecdote, but the story that when you became Minister for Foreign Affairs, you made the effort to go up to Derry and to really experience it and learn about it, which I always impress me that it, I suppose in such a busy life, you gave it such time. And I think we saw that from then on. So, Mr. Coveney.
Thank you.
Well, good evening, everybody. And nice to see lots of faces I recognize in the audience. And thank you for taking the time to be here. I'm not going to speak about Brexit tonight because you've heard me speak about it many times, and I'm happy to answer questions on it, though, because I know there's an important vote happening next week in Northern Ireland on Tuesday, and I'm happy to talk about that if you'd like. But I think there are bigger things happening in the world now, and I'd like to maybe reflect and share some thoughts on some of those. So, excellencies, because I know there are some ambassadors watching online, guests and friends. To be asked to give the John Hume's European Spirit of Peace lecture in 2024 is a big honour for me. And I want to thank the Hume family, the John and Pat Hume Foundation, which is a fantastic organisation that's growing in influence all the time, and the IIEA for the invitation to be here this evening. This is the fourth edition of the European Spirit of Peace lecture. Honestly, I find it hard to believe that next August will be the fifth anniversary of John's death. Some years ago, I was walking to a meeting across Brussels on a summer's evening along one of the many narrow streets between the Grand Place and the European Parliament. To my surprise, I saw a face I recognized walking quite frantically towards me, his face anxious and furrowed, glasses loose at the end of his nose, sweat dripping from his forehead, jacket in one hand, tie loosened, his shirt wet through to the skin. It was John Hume. I couldn't believe it. A hero of mine, one of the reasons, in fact, why I committed to entering politics in the first instance, and a key reason why I entered European politics for a time too. I could see he was in distress. So I ran over, stood in front of him, stopped his stride. He looked up at me a little irritated and said, "Do I know you?" I replied, "Probably not, but I certainly know you." I asked him if I could help. He paused, looked at me again, told me he was lost. Lost in a city that he knew well, unable to find his hotel, despite having the address written down. He was due to give a lecture. He was already an hour late. He'd been walking for hours. What started that evening as an unexpected encounter with the then vulnerable John Hume developed into a conversation that hasn't left me since. He told me that human beings need each other, particularly when we're weak or lost. He told me about his belief in the European Union and why he was in Brussels that day. He told me that story that many of you have heard many times, but when he told me it in person, it was more powerful, of arriving in Strasbourg for the first time in 1979, walking across the bridge from Strasbourg in France to Kiel in Germany, casting his mind back to what it must have looked like 30 years earlier, at the end of the Second World War. It had been the worst half century in the history of mankind. 50 million people had killed each other. But 30 years later, a bridge had been built, a new union created at the heart of a new Europe to guarantee peace in an absence of war. It was like he wanted to impart wisdom to a stranger he'd just met. I'm told by those close to him that he did that a lot, but that day I felt special. He told me the European Union is the best example in the history of conflict resolution, and he outlined the principles at the heart of it that he said should be sent to every war-torn region in the world. There was no forgetting for John Hume when it came to the principles of peacemaking, as true for him in Northern Ireland as across the EU. The three principles that so many of you have heard are respect for difference, because it's an accident of birth. The need to build institutions that respect that difference, like the EU had tried to do. A commitment to a healing process that involves working together for common interests, spilling sweat, not blood. We walked together for nearly 30 minutes to reach his hotel. It wasn't nearby. He didn't ask my name, but simply trusted me to help him, guide him to where he needed to be, while he returned the favor with life lessons in tolerance and generosity. It didn't really matter how many times you heard John Hume recount the same stories, in person or on screen, reinforcing the same principles. The authenticity and truth remain powerful, as it does today. I remember the conversation was so compelling for me that when we arrived at his hotel, we kept walking together to the elevator and all the way up to his room. As he opened the door, he looked back at me, still a little disheveled, but more relaxed now. He thanked me for my help. He smiled and said, "I do know who you are, by the way. I remember meeting you in Cork. Good luck for the future." Obviously, Cork made a big impression. That conversation, that focus on conflict and how to bring it to an end, seems more relevant now than ever. You get the sense that much of the world has lost its way, with tension and conflict rising, forgetting what should be familiar lessons of history. Despite knowing what it takes to prevent and end conflict, the path we are on is surely pointing in the wrong direction today, globally. The international community has somehow facilitated the emergence of another dark period of human history, including on our own continent, where escalating conflict has the capacity to spiral into something even more brutal and savage than what we've already witnessed in recent years. Ireland, through a new government in 2025, needs to think very carefully about how we position ourselves to protect our own interests and our people, but also to maximize our influence on global affairs as a force for good and a credible voice for peace. Europe is at war again. The horrors of Russian aggression in Ukraine is fundamentally changing European politics. Poland is preparing for conflict, building a defensive wall called its Eastern Shield on its borders with Russia and Belarus. It will spend $2.5 billion on 7,500 kilometers of fortifications, equipped with warning and detection systems, sophisticated logistics bases, anti-drone systems, and anti-tank ditches. Polish Prime Minister Donald Tusk said, "Everything we do here on the border is aimed at deterring and discouraging a potential aggressor. So it's really an investment in peace." This is the largest project of its type in the history of Europe since 1945. Sweden too is preparing and has begun sending millions of pamphlets advising residents how to prepare for possible war. Finland likewise has launched a new public information website to the same effect. Defence spending in virtually every EU country has increased significantly, and NATO ministers are meeting as regularly as EU foreign ministers these days in Brussels. Power and influence in our union has shifted to the east, as historic and current threats from Russia have become central to so much of EU thinking and decision making, not just on defence. Ireland needs to get real on the security and defence debate within the EU if we are to remain credible and influential, as I said, not only on defence issues, but on many other political choices too. If I'm honest, the debate on defence in Ireland is simply not in tune with the realities that faces Europe today. We are outliers, and some would describe us as freeloaders. Getting things done in the EU is about alliances. It's about trust and solidarity. As we found out during the Brexit years, when our vulnerabilities were exposed and we needed the support of others. We need to be much more plugged into the political and security fears being felt by many of our fellow EU member states. Solidarity means to mean something beyond words, to be real. Our purpose, of course, must be focused on peace, not war. But to be heard and to be anyway influential within the EU, serious engagement on common security and defence issues is imperative. Ireland must play its part and be seen to play our part. 2 weeks ago, I was with the ambassador of Japan to Ireland in Cork, as it happens, opening an extraordinary exhibition reflecting on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, nearly 80 years on. On the 6th of August, 1945, an atomic bomb was dropped on Hiroshima, resulting in the immediate deaths of 80,000 people, 140,000 by the end of that year. 3 days later, a bomb was dropped on Nagasaki, killing 40,000 immediately, 70,000 by the end of 1945. The catastrophic consequences altered the very fabric of society in Japan. In our current geopolitical climate, particularly in Ukraine and across the Middle East, historic lessons should remain very current. Escalating conflicts involving military superpowers have the potential to spiral into situations where the use of nuclear weapons is again being threatened. The line between conventional warfare and a justification for nuclear confrontation can be blurred when a country's core interests are threatened, whether that's perceived, manufactured, or real. In truth, Ireland has limited influence on the outcomes of large-scale conflict. But we must use that influence wisely to prioritize dialogue over escalating confrontation. We must be part of international efforts within and outside the EU to face down those who seek total victories through force of arms, allowing fear and aggression to dictate their actions. We should be open to using whatever tools are available to us: international courts, UN bodies, EU institutions, bilateral relations, partnerships, trade tools, and sanctions where possible. We must respect difference, but also insist on accountability and the protections of international law, even if that means uncomfortable truths. Today, history is repeating itself. hundreds of thousands dead in nearly 3 years of war in Ukraine. One aggressor trying to force its will on another country, fighting for its very survival. In the Middle East, a war that started with a savage terrorist attack has become an indelible stain on the international community's ability to protect civilians from a brutal war in Gaza and Lebanon. In Syria too, conflict is escalating again, with outside influence funding and arming warring parties in the Northwest. The civil war in Sudan continues to kill tens of thousands, again supported and funded by outside interests, and is largely ignored by international power brokers. The human cost of these conflicts is shocking. Take this fact into your mind's eye. The most frequent age of people killed in the war in Gaza is below 9 years of age. I'm sure it was never the intention, but this has been a war on children. On average, almost 50 children every single day for an entire year have been killed. This is what human beings are capable of when conflict goes unchallenged, when difference is not respected, when international institutions don't work, and when there is no common purpose. Of course, diagnosing the problem is a lot easier than finding pathways to peace. The politics of conflicts around the world is complex. Added to that, the reality that the truth is the first casualty in every war, so it's always hard to know what exactly we're dealing with. But Ireland is and must continue to form positions on world affairs based on strategic alliances and EU principles, of course, but also on the basis of international law and the UN Charter, things that we thought we could take for granted, at least in the democratic world, but not so today. That's how the Irish voice remains credible, consistent, and I hope respected by most. Multilateralism is supposed to be the protector of small nations. The UN has not covered itself in glory in recent years, failing to prevent multiple conflicts from happening or protect civilians. But it is still the only multilateral institution that can coordinate global responses and protections at scale. And we must speak up when the UN is being undermined or discredited for political or propaganda purposes, often by countries that should know better. I fear we will see a more polarized, transactional, divided geopolitical landscape in the months and years to come. Ireland will be pressurized to make choices linked to other countries' agendas. We need to make our own choices on the basis of a foreign policy that has served us well, committed to the EU and UN, consistent with international law, signed conventions, and international court rulings, regardless of the inconvenience of some of that. In other words, we must push against the forces of populism, corrosive nationalism, promises of quick fixes based on emotion and fear, the kind of politics that embeds and weaponizes difference, making conflict inevitable. Geopolitical tension and a more polarized world threatens Ireland's economic well-being too. We share a fantastic but small globalized country with reach into over 100 markets around the world. Our trade is now valued at over $1 trillion with a healthy trade surplus. We've thrived, in truth, on the back of an outward-looking focus in the world that embraced globalization. Ireland, an island at the center of the world, has been our template, inviting the best and largest companies in the world to make Ireland their home for global innovation. More than 1,800 multinationals today employ over 620,000 people, directly or indirectly. That's more than a quarter of our entire workforce. We continue to shape our economic model in the image of global trends, in tech, in healthcare, in financial services, in engineering, in energy, nutrition. Irish and international companies, free to trade under international rules, serving global markets. So where are the storm clouds now? And why do we need to rethink economic resilience as well as solutions to conflict? Many of us are closely watching the taking shape of a new Trump administration with curiosity, knowing that a new policy direction matters for Irish interests. Some key picks that I think we should take note of: Secretary of State, Senator Marco Rubio, an able politician, very hawkish on China, Iran, and the Middle East, voted against the last aid package for Ukraine and talks of the need for difficult choices to end the war there. Wants to prioritize the Indo-Pacific. He says the future of the 21st century is going to largely be defined by what happens in the Indo-Pacific. So where to the transatlantic relationship? Treasury Secretary Scott Bessent, Wall Street financier seen by many as less radical than others, talks about a new golden age with deregulation, low-cost energy, and low taxes, but also very focused on ending trade imbalances. The US doesn't have a trade deficit with many countries, but it has with us. Commerce Secretary Howard Lutnick, the man to spearhead the administration's tariff and trade agenda. He's already been busy threatening significant tariffs on Mexico, Canada, and China. He has specifically spoken about Ireland running a trade surplus at America's expense. Energy Secretary Chris White, an oil and gas industry executive. He says he will fulfill the campaign promise of drill, baby, drill to maximize US oil and gas production. He's recently posted a video saying there is no climate crisis, and we're not in the midst of an energy transition either. So Ireland must prepare for a friend in the White House who sees the world very differently to the way we do. The economists, environmentalists, and commentators who are raising alarm bells should not be ignored. Our government will need to be politically streetwise, maintain strong relationships in Washington and across other US states. We may have friends in the US in both parties, and we need to keep them. But we are in for a period of potentially very serious disruption to transatlantic trade and global trade more widely. So we need to be planning now for how the most globalized economy in Europe positions itself, domestically from an economic perspective and internationally between Europe and the US in a world where globalization is clearly in retreat. We should distinguish too between the policies of the White House and that of many US multinationals, particularly based here, on their commitments to energy transition, net zero, and trading around the world. The EU and Ireland should also be strengthening trade, security, and political relationships with our closest neighbor in the UK, in the context of a very different policy direction on both sides of the Atlantic. The UK is a valuable and important ally for Ireland and the EU, and that is the way we should see them. There are opportunities, of course, for Ireland, particularly in attracting FDI, looking for political certainty, stability, and predictability. And I was relieved the electorate agreed to maintain that stability last Friday. A few negotiations yet, but you would expect it'll work out. 2024 has been a year of elections around the world. Around half of the world's population across 70 countries have held national and significant elections. The results mean a deeply divided global outlook on so many of the world's key drivers and disruptors. The direction of travel is anything but clear. And by the way, that goes for the European Union as well as it does for other parts of the world. This idea that we are not going to be challenged by difference in terms of perspective and ideology and politics within the European Union is something that I think needs a reality check. For a globalized, connected island like Ireland, we need to protect what we've built, but also be agile and willing to adapt to new realities, threats, and opportunities. So let's not forget what served us well EU membership, a deep commitment to multilateralism and protecting it, a willingness to call out breaches of international law and an insistence on accountability without double standards, and a constant focus on dialogue, compromise, and peace building. I think tonight, but more generally, it's time to remind ourselves of the values, humility, and politics of John Hume. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That was very moving, and I'm sure for people who knew John Hume personally, even more so, and very moving in every way, politically, and about where we are now in the world, and about Ireland's role. I have a couple of questions, and although Northern Ireland is my area, I'm going to try and avoid it a little, because you said you wanted to be more international.
Some questions on Northern Ireland and Brexit, so I am very happy to answer them, by the way, if you want me to.
Two general questions. You've mentioned the need for the UK, EU and Irish partnership to work well, given all the challenges that are faced now. How do you see, I think all of us were relieved when Labour won the British election. I suppose, how do you see the state of the relationship now, and what are the challenges ahead?
Well, look, I've always believed that the closer the relationship between the UK and Ireland, the better. The stronger the UK is, in many ways, the better for Ireland in terms of economic opportunity, trade, political relationships, and so on. In truth, the Irish and British relationship was strained to an extent that I certainly hadn't seen in my political lifetime during the Brexit years. I don't believe the Irish vulnerabilities, if you want to call them that, were respected to the extent that they should have been. And that created a lot of tension. And I think some in the UK, in the previous government, I think saw Ireland as a sort of a blocker and a barrier to what they wanted to achieve. And that created tension and frustration. I have to say that, since we managed to get agreement around the Windsor framework, a lot of that tension has changed the tone and the relationship between two governments. And certainly after the British general election, I think Prime Minister Starmer is somebody who likes Ireland, knows Ireland, travels here, has traveled here regularly, has spent a lot of time in Northern Ireland. I think he has an understanding and an interest and a sense of responsibility towards that relationship perhaps we haven't seen for a while. I mean, I think if you think about it, I was a foreign minister for 5.5 years. During that period, there were 4 British prime ministers, 5 foreign secretaries, 6 secretaries of state for Northern Ireland, and 7 Brexit spokespeople. So when you think about that for a second, it's very hard to build a trusting relationship with a government that is chopping and changing and in chaos at times. That doesn't mean that they were bad people. It just meant that the relationship was very difficult. And I think the stability that we're seeing now will allow, that's not to say that the current British government don't feel pressures, they do, but they have a big majority. And I think one of Keir Starmer's early decisions was to meet the Irish Taoiseach to come here. And to try and reset, if you like, the relationships between the two governments. So that's really good. We're going to have an annual meet between the two governments, which is agreed between the Prime Minister and Taoiseach. And I think that is going to focus both governments on trying to make that relationship work, prepare for it properly, and look at the bilateral relationship through a different lens. So all of that's really good. But I do think that the election in the US is going to potentially ask of the UK some very awkward questions from a trade perspective. The US is a very important partner of the UK, just like they are for us. And already we've seen some people who are very influential in the Trump administration almost goading the British government
in terms of their policies and their choices. And we've, you know, we've heard this sort of confrontational style, which is, you know, choose our way rather than the Europeans' way, and, you know, this type of stuff. So I think we're going to see a bit of that, and that's why, you know, for me, I hope Ireland can be a real friend of Britain in the European Union, and I hope we can be at least partly a catalyst to improve that relationship, because I think a lot has changed since Brexit. This isn't just about, you know, a single market protecting its integrity. This is also about broader security questions in the context of our continent and Britain's key role in those discussions, as well as obviously trade. So I'm optimistic that we're in a much better place than we have been for a number of years. And I know that whatever new government is formed, presumably in January, we'll see a big effort, I think, in trying to continue that momentum that's positive. Because look, we will face difficult challenges in Northern Ireland, for example, at times. And when the two governments are working together, I think most people here, and there's a lot of experience in this room, but when the two governments have a good relationship or working together, when the Secretary of State is working closely with his or her counterpart in Dublin, that's generally when Northern Ireland works too.
Yeah.
But when, you know, when different parties look to different governments to try to reinforce positions on things like legacy, for example, that's when we create division and tension. And the political system in Northern Ireland is, from my experience, often isn't able to deal with some of those divisive questions on their own, which is why the two governments need to be part of the discussion. And, you know, that partnership and cooperation between the two governments has been very absent during the Brexit process, which I think is regrettable, but fixing.
Thank you. It's positive. My second and last question about time. I was reading, I think it was probably 2 years ago, Brian Feeney, which I'm sure some people know here personally, I don't know him, writing in the Irish News that the Shared Island Initiative and the way I think many of us were, again, brought up to believe in certain values that Mr. Coveney has stated so clearly from John Hume, that that's old hat, that was the 90s. And because of the challenges that you've talked about, we need to, in a way, those of us who differ, need to move on and accept that unification is the, or reunification is how the world is now. It's a realist world. So I suppose I was quite upset by that, but you seem hopeful that those with different approaches might be able to still have influence.
Yeah, so I mean, I think the focus of everybody in this island in the short term needs to be on rebuilding relationships. On trying to ensure that the institutions of the Good Friday Agreement can function, that the dysfunction of the last 6 or 7 years is addressed by as much positivity as possible. And that's why the Shared Island Initiative, I think, has been, I think, a very good initiative, funding and supporting projects that are cross-border in nature to try and create a kind of a normalization around that interaction, partnership, and so on. I don't think we should dodge the question of constitutional change on this island. I think we need to be honest about it, but I really think we also need to be generous too. And so people who advocate for, you know, the setting up of an immediate citizens' assembly to work out all of the logistics of what a United Ireland might look like, you know, when actually unionists won't even take part, understandably, because it's a predetermined outcome. You know, I don't think that's helpful. But, you know, I have to say, I see, you know, Irish people north of the border as Irish as I see myself. You know, they are Irish people. That's their right under the Good Friday Agreement in terms of recognition. And the aspiration for constitutional change is perfectly legitimate, just like the aspiration that wouldn't happen is legitimate too in terms of the unionist mindset. So for me, I think the focus needs to be around how do we interact with each other? If we believe the demographics are going to change the picture in the future in terms of a potential majority looking for constitutional change, well, then there's a real onus on the people who believe that majority will come about to be generous in terms of what that change might look like, as opposed to being divisive with this attitude of times are changing, get on the train or we leave you behind. You know, I think that is the kind of almost aggressive approach towards it that actually results in a lot of members of the unionist community being very fearful. And so we need to avoid the kind of triumphalist approach to sort of winners and losers. And I think, you know, John Hume's teaching around trying to get a Good Friday Agreement where there was no winners and no losers is actually, you know, I think a good lesson. But certainly I think for the foreseeable future, while of course a new Irish government needs to prepare for all eventualities and think about what they might look like, I think we also need to primarily focus on trying to build some trust, so that people who are fearful, perhaps for the wrong reasons, can have some of those fears addressed. You know, I don't believe the unionist community has anything to fear from a government in Dublin. But I don't believe that many in the unionist communities believe that to be so. So there is a need, I think, for real effort and generosity. And I think the starting point of that should be, we have an agreement. We have institutions that haven't fulfilled their potential. We need to focus on that. And let's see where it takes us in terms of change in attitudes in Northern Ireland. And I think perhaps the place to start is to look at how we, you know, commemorate past atrocities and killings on all sides, whether it's loyalists or Republicans, and change the tone and language around the past. And of course, with the British government, work towards an approach to legacy that not everybody will be happy with, but everybody can accept, because it's almost impossible to have a perfect approach towards dealing with something as traumatic and difficult and divisive as the legacy of the past. But I certainly think we can do a better job than what was on offer from the last British government, which very much acted unilaterally, without the support of the Irish government, or indeed the support of any of the political parties in Northern Ireland, which was really quite an extraordinary thing to do on such a sensitive issue. So look, there's a lot of work to do. A lot of it's very sensitive, but I think the Irish government needs to be leaning into it with openness and generosity and wanting to hear from all communities in Northern Ireland in a way that hasn't been easy to do during the Brexit years because of the obvious divisions, which of course became linked to the identity debates, which made it very, very difficult.
Thank you very much. So I won't hog the floor anymore. Questions, if you could introduce yourself briefly.
Good evening, Simon. And my name is Chris Hudson. I'm a Unitarian minister in Belfast. So originally from Dublin, but I'm based in Belfast for the last 20 years. So I welcome your comments on Northern Ireland, particularly around the constitutional issue. I must say I have a very Burkean approach to the constitutional issue, and that is leave well enough alone. I think the constitutional position of Northern Ireland and the Republic worked fine, and anything we want to do, we can do. There is no need to change the constitutional position of Northern Ireland. And I do believe that the continuous talking of constitutional change, in actual fact, in part, undermines the better functioning of the Good Friday institutions in Northern Ireland. But that's not the question I wanted to ask you. The question I want to ask you is this. Likewise, we all agree that the Ukraine war is a major, serious issue for Europe. And recently I was visiting the Baltic states, and I got a sense of that there with Polish troops and British troops based in both Latvia and Estonia. But the reality is that the European Union was slow to react. And he's not everybody's favorite person, but if Boris Johnson had not gone and stood with Zelensky in the Ukraine, the Ukraine could now today be under Russian control. It was very disappointing how slow Europe was when you had President Macron making ridiculous phone calls to Putin, which was a waste of time. So in part, and I know he might not everybody's cup of tea either, President Trump, he will be here. He will come in the end of January. And his criticism of the European Union, or Europe at the time, at not coming up to the mark in financing NATO was understandable at that time. And it was worrying that America could move away from... And the last thing I just want to ask you, Drew, do you regret, as Minister of Foreign Affairs, that your government had an opportunity to remove the triple lock, which would have freed up Ireland's position regarding probably even supporting the Ukraine? Thank you, Simon.
Okay, well, a lot of questions there. I don't agree with you that we should take the approach of just leaving well alone in terms of the constitutional state, because if you do that because that's your own view, which I respect, by the way, you ignore the views and aspirations and dreams of so many others. And if you do that, you'll find that you lose control of the debate and somebody else will take it in a new direction. So you've got to engage in debates where there is uncomfortable discussion, in my view, but you need to do it in a way that is consistent and truthful and honest and generous, and really trying to make an effort to understand different perspectives. I think if we take an approach in Northern Ireland that, look, let's just leave well alone, actually, Northern Ireland isn't functioning very well. Finds it difficult to deal with the divisive nature of many debates and discussions. And we'll see that next week in the context of the vote on the Windsor framework. So I think I do understand what you're saying. I think the emphasis should be on relationships right now and on ensuring that the institutions of the Good Friday Agreement that are part of an international agreement should be the main focus, because they haven't been functioning as they should. But I think it would be a mistake to ignore the constitutional question when a large minority in Northern Ireland want to discuss it. So how we discuss it is the question that I think parties in Northern Ireland and the two governments need to be discussing, so that we can do it in a responsible way. On the questions of Ukraine, I don't think your criticism actually of the European Union is fair. The European Union, it makes up 27 countries, so they don't make decisions in the same way that the US does or the UK does, where there is essentially one central government and decision maker. It does take a little longer. But actually, and I was a foreign minister at the time, I've never seen an issue to unite the European Union like the war in Ukraine. Like, it was quite extraordinary. We passed, I don't know how many different rounds of sanctions in the space of like 6 weeks. It must have been four or five. Literally every week I was back to Brussels, adding more. Like, this was unheard of for the European Union to make decisions at this pace. The billions of euros that the EU is giving to Ukraine in terms of keeping the lights on, paying teachers, paying doctors, outside of military assistance now, is very, very significant. And shouldn't be underestimated. Boris Johnson was very proactive, that's true, in terms of giving support and solidarity in terms of military support to Ukraine. And I think he acted quickly on that, to his credit. But I think you do have to understand how the European Union works on something as controversial as military aid into Ukraine, to actually understand actually how remarkable it was that they went as far as they did, as quickly as they did. Like I say, I've never seen anything unite. And if you actually look at the, and I talked about it earlier in my speech, the drivers and influencers within the European Union have shifted to the east. Poland is a much more influential country in the European Union now than it was a few years ago. And the Baltic states, you know, are listened to in a much more serious way on Russia than they would previously have been. I think there is a lot in what you're saying, but I don't totally agree with it. And then on the, what was the last question again? Oh, the triple lock. Yeah. So like for me, and I'm looking at Mark Mellett here in the room, who was the chief of staff of the Irish Defence Forces for many years. Look, I mean, I think the triple lock is just outdated. We should change it. It should be the Irish Parliament and the Irish government that decides where Irish troops go, not somebody in New York who decides to veto a resolution for other political reasons, whether that's whichever P5 member it might be. So I think we should do that. I'd like to try to get as much agreement across party as we can. And unfortunately, the neutrality thing sometimes becomes party political in the Irish Parliament. In the same way, by the way, that sometimes what's happening in the Middle East and Gaza and Lebanon becomes party political, unfortunately, at times. It almost becomes like a contest for who can say the most emotive things. I think the discussion on defence in Ireland needs to be a more honest one. I think Micheál Martin has tried to do that in Ireland and got a lot of criticism, in my view, unfairly so, for trying to do that. It is just simply completely out of sync with the discussions that the rest of the world are having. Irish neutrality, I think, Irish non-alignment, because I think that is the more accurate term. We're not neutral. We're not neutral in the war in Ukraine. We're not neutral in relation to the Middle East conflict. We're not neutral in relation to defending EU values. We're not neutral in relation to protecting Irish interests. But we are non-aligned militarily. I don't advocate for Ireland to join NATO. I don't think that's necessarily a particularly, positive asset for NATO or for Ireland. I think we can do a lot outside of NATO, but we certainly should be very much involved in common security and defence discussions within the European Union. And we are, by the way, but I think we need to put a lot more resources into that, given the size and scale of Irish territory and Ireland's relevance in terms of our geographic position on the west coast of the European Union. So it's not a big secret. When I was defense minister, we put together a commission on the future of the Irish Defence Forces, which effectively called for a doubling of the defense budget in Ireland. And I think, I hope this incoming government will see that through, because that's at least what we need. And a whole range of other things, so that we're seen to be and being serious about this issue. Threats that we just didn't think could materialize 10 years ago are now very real in the world today. And that's not to be sort of naive about it, but it's just true. And Ireland is a wealthy, modern country. And actually, in particular, if we're not aligned militarily, well, then we have to have at least basic capacities in terms of defense and intelligence and so on. And we do have some capacity, but in my view, it's not sufficient for the world we're living in today. And that's why we hear commentary of Ireland being a freeloader and so on. And I think that's sort of frustration coming from other countries, that they'd like to see a country as wealthy as Ireland investing more in collective EU security issues.
Thank you. We're very short of time, so for the next people asking questions, could you keep it to a question?
Yeah, and I'll try and keep the answers a bit short.
You've a right to speak, it's actually great to hear such a candid response, so I think there are no problems there. But we do need people not to give commentaries, just to give questions very concisely in a sentence or two, max. So I'm sorry about the time. We need hours. I think you were next.
There's a couple of people in the back there.
Oh, okay.
Sorry. Yeah, do you want to take two or three together?
That one, and for gender balance, if I could have your question as well, and then the man in the front. Ooh, and we also have an online question. So I will try my best to manage this.
Tom Ferris, life member at the IIEA. It is looking for strands that go cross-border. And in that context, it was interesting recently where a program called DESH, Disadvantaged Children, went cross-border with the assistance of the Shared Ireland Fund and Minister Foley and Minister Gavin. It is the small things that can count.
Oh, thank you. Okay, so...
Agreed.
Yeah, so questions, preferably.
Okay, second question, Ellen Gunning, a member of the IIEA as well. I wonder, the one thing that you didn't seem to touch on in your speech, which was absolutely fantastic, was the threat of social media and bots and those influencers that will be, I think, a major threat to democracy and to the EU in the future. And I'd just like to hear your thoughts on that, please.
As the first one was a comment you agreed with, can I move to an online question very quickly from Evelyn Mulrow, CAO of the Cancer Trials Ireland. Given the recent general election down here, how do you think John Hume would view the SDLP's place in politics on the island? And she also asks for support about the and questions about actual life and death that relies on cross-border north-south cooperation in her area of cancer. But that's a comment, I think.
Yeah. Well, do you want me to take those three?
Yes.
And I'll try to give quick answers because I know there's other people who want to raise other questions and I'd like to facilitate that. Yeah. So first of all, how would John Hume? I don't know, to be honest. I'd say Mark Durkin would know a lot better than me there. he knew John much, much better than I did, as a lot of people in this room did. Unfortunately, you know, I really only got to know John when he was very impacted by dementia. And in fact, I got to know Pat Hume an awful lot better than John Hume, just because of when I came along in politics. But I've read a lot about John Hume. I think he's one of the extraordinary personalities of the last 100 years in Ireland. And actually, as time goes by, I think people will begin to treasure him even more, which is why I know that I've been working with the John and Pat Hume Institute on trying to build something in Derry that would be a sort of a fitting tribute and reflection on John's thinking, actually, as opposed to individual events, because I think it's an important political philosophy that is losing traction around the world today. The SDLP is under new leadership. I think she's a super new leader. I really wish her well. I know Claire very well. And I wish her well. I think the SDLP is a very important force for good on this island, north and south, by the way, which is why the relationships that the SDLP has with parties like mine and Fianna Fáil and the Labour Party, and I presume the Soc Dems as well, is something that I hope they'll continue to prioritise, because it's important. And many people in my party actually have learned about the complexity of politics in Northern Ireland, I suspect, Nora, from SDLP friends and colleagues who speak very candidly to them. Certainly, I've learned a lot. In terms of Ellen, yeah, look, I mean, I was actually going to talk. I gave a speech a couple of weeks ago about what I described as the sort of the five mega drivers of disruption in the world. And technology is very much one of them. In truth, the political process is really struggling to deal with what technology is now capable of. Like, it's very hard to know when you read on your phones political messaging on social media platforms, what's true and what's not. Like, it's really, really hard to know. It's put huge pressure on mainstream media to be much more sensationalist, to be much more emotive in terms of their headlines, their photographs, to be much more immediate. And that, in my view, has had quite a corrosive impact on political discussion and dialogue. And what sells is actually division. It's emotion, it's anger, it's humor. It's not actually just informing and providing context around certain decisions. And so I think mainstream media, but also the political system, everyone's trying to get a handle on how to use new technology more effectively, and because of the competitive nature of politics, that means taking risk. And we are, I think, chasing the pace of change with inadequate regulation to try to actually avoid the use of technology distorting democracy. And like, I would say the biggest threat to democracy today actually isn't populism or any political philosophy. It is actually the pace of technology and changing the way in which political debate is interact. I mean, if you look at, for example, how it's used around the migration debate in Ireland, you know, this country was very self-righteous up until a couple of years ago around the politics of inward migration, commenting on countries like Italy and many other countries in the West, on the eastern sides of Europe, who were struggling to deal with migration and, you know, putting up fences and taking hardline positions and so on. Well, Ireland faces that debate now, as does Britain, as does, you know, but if you see how social media is used to actually, you know, to turn, you know, what are sometimes minor incidents into huge points of tension within communities, and political parties have taken the view, well, you know, if you can't beat them, join them, you know, in terms of how you create emotive messages and so on. And I just think that as we move into an AI generated communications world, who knows where it's going to take us in truth, but it's a huge disruptor. There are fantastically useful tools that come from technology and new comms, but there's also huge risk, I think, and we've seen that. And you know, Noreen and Mark in particular will know just how much resource is going in to try and impact and undermine election results in different parts of the world. You take Georgia, for example, like extraordinary pressures being funded from outside, looking to undermine democracy. And it's a big, big issue that I think the European Union collectively is trying to give leadership on. Ironically, when you give leadership in this space and you introduce regulation, you're then accused of actually undermining innovation. And you start to lose a lot of the research that actually goes elsewhere because they fear regulation. So there's this constant balance between appropriate levels of regulation and at the same time encouraging and supporting innovation and new technologies. So it's a very, very difficult debate that I could have spent a long time on tonight, but I decided there were other things I needed to say. Tom, I agree, Desh, great example. By the way, healthcare is one of the great examples of cross-border cooperation. Whether it's people leaving Bandon in West Cork to get their cataracts done in Belfast, or whether it's children coming from Northern Ireland for specialist treatment in Dublin, you know, there's been great cooperation on healthcare. Auchnagalvin Hospital in Derry, a really good example, which the Irish government has partly funded because, of course, it's treating loads of patients from Donegal. I'd like to see more of that. I know some people when I look to do more on a cross-border basis, you know, I get sort of conspiracy theorists thinking, oh, this is sort of creeping unification. like it's not. It's just trying to create normal relationships. Like we've had agriculture, by the way, is probably the best example of all. Farmers just buy and sell to each other. Do you know what I mean? Across the border. And they have been doing for years. We need to focus on that practical cooperation. And Desh, by the way, is a great program in Ireland. And one of the things I've learned spending a lot of time in Northern Ireland, and many of you will know it, is that there are deep divisions in society in Northern Ireland linked to educational disadvantage, particularly in loyalist communities, actually. And Desh as a model, it's not the perfect model, but it is something that I hope can offer potential frameworks and solutions in Northern Ireland that might be of use.
Thank you. I've been given permission to go on a bit longer if it's okay with you.
Oh yeah, I'm
so many questions.
I'm relaxed, yeah.
This gentleman in front has been waiting patiently, so, and then your question immediately. We'll take two together.
Yeah, just to say thanks very much. My name is Mark Millett. I'm a former Chief of Staff of the Defence Forces. And thank you for your dystopian security environment assessment. Somebody needs to call it. And against that background, and you mentioned the strengthening of the institutions in the EU, do you see the political will to strengthen bilateral defence relations with the UK, our nearest European neighbour, and strengthen our bilateral relations with the US, our nearest transatlantic neighbour? Thank you.
Thank you. Next question. Again, briefly, thank you.
Matt O'Neill, IIEA. You mentioned next week's winter framework vote.
Yeah.
I wanted to ask, how do we flip the discussion around being from traditional divisions in Northern Ireland to it actually being about a vote on foreign policy that has been given to a devolved nation with a lower capital F, essentially? It's a huge vote, lack of really a lot of knowledge around European issues, I find, within the sort of political system. And it's going back to the old traditions and narrative rather than actually talking about it in a new way, yeah. Impacting. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
So both questions.
Do you want to take those? Yeah, Mark, if I'm honest, I think any Irish government will be cautious in this space. You know, there is a lot of historical baggage in terms of defence cooperation with the UK.
Linked to Northern Ireland, primarily.
Having said that, I mean, when I was a defence minister, I think I was the first minister to sign an MOU with the UK on defence in terms of joint procurement. I mean, look, obviously their procurement is 100 times the size of ours and more. But, you know, we have an obligation to get value for money in terms of what we're buying. And we have an obligation to ensure that we have interoperability in terms of our equipment with other European countries, which effectively means NATO standards, because we may well be in, you know, on peacekeeping missions and peace training missions with the UK, unlikely to be with the US. But the truth is that for Irish soldiers to be safe, they need to be training with, using similar equipment to, and understand the systems that are used by NATO forces around the world. So that if we move in, like we did in the past in Afghanistan, when Ireland came in specifically for a demining program, that actually we were working with people who undergo the same type of training systems that we have. So I think that as we spend more on defense, because we need to, not because we want war or we want conflict or we want tension, we need to protect Irish core interests. You know, whether that's cybersecurity, whether it's, pipelines offshore, whether it's wind turbines offshore, whatever it is, you know, we need to have the capacity to provide basic defense of our assets and our people. We need to be able to respond to a terrorist attack, God forbid, if it ever happens here on scale. I hope it won't, but you never know. So we have an obligation, in my view, to follow through on the template that has been put in place for Ireland in the Commission report, which is a really good piece of work. And it was done by very balanced, mature people, both in the Irish and international context. And I think as part of that, cooperation with our closest neighbour makes a lot of sense, I have to say. Obviously, there needs to be lines drawn in certain areas. We don't have or want offensive military capacity. Ours is it's a very different approach around defensive and peacekeeping and so on. But we have a skill set that I think needs to be enhanced and supported with both more people and more equipment. And I think we should be talking to our closest neighbour and indeed other, like our closest EU neighbour too, France, that has a lot of capacity in this space that I think can help Ireland. On the US, look, you know, we have a US military attaché here. We have a very good relationship with the US. Their military objectives and the whole setup is so different in terms of scale and objective to Ireland. You know, I think the relationships with other countries that have, you know, peacekeeping focus, defensive focus, and so on is probably more likely. But look, you know, the US is a friend of Ireland. You know, we're not in NATO. We're not ever going to go to war with side by side with the US or anything like that. But I think we should be talking to all of our friends in the context of, ensuring that we have modern infrastructure that's up to date and that is most effective and impactful. And I think that means talking to our neighbours on both sides, the UK and the US, but predominantly our core anchor here does need to be common security and defence in the European Union. Like, that's the union we're part of. That's the policy area where Ireland is part of the debate. And I think we should prioritise that. On the vote next week, you know, unfortunately, this vote, I don't think, is going to be about the detail of the Windsor framework. Unfortunately, it's going to be, for many people, an expression of political identity again. You know, like, if you look at the maths of this, I think I'm right in saying there are 37 unionist votes, 35 nationalist votes, and 18 others. You know, I think this will be carried because you know, the Alliance believes that there's no alternative to the Windsor framework. I think they're right. I don't think there is. I think it's helpful that the British government has actually produced a paper and report on assessment of the Windsor framework to date. Effectively, it's drawn the conclusion that there's nothing better on offer. And we would have problems if we didn't have the Windsor framework that couldn't be easily resolved. So I hope the vote will go through. Look, I know the unionist parties don't like it. They don't like the fact that this doesn't require a cross-community vote. But you know what? Like, when Brexit was decided in Northern Ireland, there was no cross-community vote. Like, let's face it. So let's not, you know, pick and choose arguments that suit. Like, the truth is, this was negotiated and agreed on the basis of what the majority wants in Northern Ireland. You know, if you were to have a cross-community vote on endorsing or collapsing the Windsor framework, you're essentially saying that a minority in Northern Ireland would be able to actually determine what the majority has to live with. I don't think that would be democratic either, with all due respect. Like, I think the cross-community vote is a very important part of the Good Friday Agreement in terms of how decisions are made on community-based issues in Northern Ireland. So you don't effectively have a minority community effectively getting bullied by a majority vote. But the Windsor framework, I think, is different. You know, this is an international agreement. And the idea that Windsor framework would collapse on the back of a minority saying that it should, you know, I don't think that's a solid argument, I have to say. But look, the vote takes place on the 10th. I think that's next Tuesday, isn't it? So look, I hope it can pass without too much rancor and that we can get on and try and make it work as best we can on all sides.
Thank you. One very quick question from a listener in the Netherlands. If I can, online, and then we will finish. Senator Eddie Hartog, in the Netherlands asked, how can the EU improve our mutual understanding, or how can we in the EU improve our mutual understanding of our different national historic roots that determines our views of global affairs? That's a hard question.
Well,
and you have to be brief.
Well, it was interesting, actually, because I had a conversation today with someone who I'm working with on a project at the moment. And he said something to me that really hit home. And that was that sometimes Irish people sort of think in a sort of an exceptionalist way. You know, we talk about the conflict here and our experience of conflict and our experience of a peace process and our experience of violence. And as if other countries haven't lived through it too. You know, you take a country like Poland, and the what Poland has lived through since Irish independence, yes, we've had extraordinary trauma linked to violence, particularly in Northern Ireland. That's true, but it's not like other countries haven't experienced extraordinary scale of loss, you know, particularly every country in the European Union. You know, if you speak to the Baltic states, for example, they'll quickly remind you of, you know, thousands of their children were just disappeared into parts of Russia. And you look at what's been happening in parts of the Middle East where, you know, we've seen loss of life in a week, which is the equivalent of decades of loss during our conflict. You know, so I think we do need, of course, to lean on our own experience in Ireland. That does give us credibility, and it allows us to be able to speak with some authority and credibility on conflict and how conflict can be resolved. And I think what is exceptional about Ireland is how successful a peace process has been in recent times. There are very few examples actually of successful peace process. But I think we should also remember our European history as well as our Irish history when we are positioning Ireland as part of this security debate within the European Union, because as I said earlier, solidarity in relationships is what determines how decisions are made in the European Union. Banging the table and screaming and shouting really doesn't make any difference. What happens is within the European Union is alliances, relationships, trust that's built over time, solidarity that's shown by a group of countries towards a country that's vulnerable, that's then returned when the shoe is on the other foot. And like, just to say, I mean, I spent an awful lot of my time as a foreign minister, as a Brexit spokesperson, traveling to the capitals of Europe. I think we brought, of the 27 countries, 26 countries, I think 21 of them sent foreign ministers to Ireland to physically go and see the border. Like, it was quite extraordinary when you think about it. Like, to leave Malta or Cyprus or Greece to come to the Irish border to try and understand the vulnerabilities of a member state that really, its interests have no real relation to your interests, you know, but because we were a member of the European Union, there was a solidarity that was there. Like, I think we need to remember that. Mm-hmm. And we need to remember the solidarity that we saw coming out of Paris and Berlin, when actually I'm sure they were under huge pressure from a British government to think differently. And that was because people saw a real and genuine vulnerability linked to a peace process, linked to something that was not of Ireland's making, but Ireland was being forced to deal with. You know, and when we now look at the real and genuine threat that Baltic states, Nordic states, states on the eastern borders of the European Union feel towards what's happening in Ukraine and the aggressive nature of Russia's behavior and their history in the context of their relationship with Russia, we really do need to think about how Ireland can be an EU member state that actually shows solidarity as opposed to being overly self-righteous or so there's a balance there, because that doesn't mean that you can't hold your own opinion, you know. We do need to do that because Ireland needs to be a distinctive voice around conflict. But we also need to do it in a way that I think reflects the trauma and anxiety that a lot of countries are feeling right now. Not least Ukraine itself, which I think Ireland knows an awful lot more about now than we did 4 years ago. I'm just trying to sort of make the point that sometimes, and this happens because we're an island to the west of another large island. And so the European Union, in terms of the mainland, if you want to call it that, sort of feels quite a long way away. And that's why in Irish debate, you often hear, well, this is what Europe wants us to do, as if we're not Europe.
Yes.
You know, like, you never hear that when you're in Luxembourg or in Belgium or in Lithuania or and so we need to, I think, counterbalance that island mentality of sort of separation and only looking to Europe when there's something to gain. You know, we are the European Union, and we need to protect and support member states when they're vulnerable. That's what a union is about, fundamentally. And you know, it is just so depressing that that we're seeing a scale of conflict that we're seeing right now. But like, if there's a part of the world that actually knows how to bring about an end to this kind of conflict in terms of scale and rebuild after it, it's Europe. And Ireland needs to be part of that discussion in terms of how we do that. In the short term, it's about supporting Ukraine and helping them to defend themselves so that when the negotiation happens, they have the strongest hand possible to try and get the best deal that they can. And then we need to fast track EU membership for the for Ukraine, in my view. That's going to put the EU under all sorts of strain. But what is the alternative? So anyway, look, that's a different debate, but it's the kind of debate that we don't have very often in Ireland. You know, often we have kind of simplistic debates, particularly around the Middle East, of, you know, Israel is bad, Palestine is the victim, as opposed to actually a deeper discussion around how we can bring an end to this madness that is seeing 50 children a day being killed. I think actually organizations like this one need to be part of that level of complex discussion to try to ensure that Ireland positions itself in a position that can be of value, but at the same time can keep our credibility internationally within the European Union.
Thank you. I really have to applaud that. Thank you. Firstly, thank you very much. I think we probably would all agree. Well, I think we do agree you're a loss to politics, but I know you're benefiting us all now and in your career now. But it is refreshing to hear, I think, such candid and also value-based responses. I think it's inspiring. So thank you very much.